This is the installation video series for my remote extended runtime fuel tank kit for the Yamaha EF3000iS, EF3000ISE, and EF3000ISEB. As you're possibly well aware, the three different models of generator are all sisters and use the same engine block and housing assembly. This particular unit already has my wireless remote control with the 2,000 foot range installed on it. This particular video will be covering the installation of the fuel kit itself. The first step to installing the fuel kit is to remove portions of the cabinetry. The end covers come off with 4 bolts each. You'll notice that the bolts that hold the end covers on are longer than the bolts that hold the metal covers in place, because these end covers are plastic and they have a bushing in them. But these are 16 millimeter long, 6 millimeter diameter. The fuel tank cover is held on with 4 bolts as well. Go ahead and take a break. Okay, to pull the fuel tank cover off, you undo the 4 bolts, one at each corner of the fuel tank cover. And these bolts are 12 millimeters long instead of 16. Then remove the fuel cap. It's retained by a chain. So what you'll do is just lift it up and set it sideways. Remove the fuel cap cover, the tank cover, and the fuel cap, when it's turned sideways, can be forced through this rubber gasket. The next step is going to be to remove the fuel tank. When you remove the fuel tank, either make sure that the tank is absolutely out of fuel, or take a pair of crimpers and crimp the fuel line totally shut. There's 2 fuel lines going into the back of the fuel selector valve. The one that goes straight in from the back is the one that comes from the tank. The one that comes around and makes a loop is the one that goes onto the carburetor. So I'm going to reach in and I'm going to crimp the fuel line from the fuel tank completely shut. And then I'll remove the clamp. And then the fuel tank itself is held on with 4 bolts. Incidentally, these 4 bolts are the same length as the 4 bolts that held the fuel tank cover on. And when you go to lift the fuel tank out of the way, just make sure that what you're using to crimp it with does not get caught on any of the wiring. Slide it up and just lay it on the bottom. On the California approved models, there is a vapor canister. There's two hoses going to the vapor canister. The larger one goes around to the crankcase breather valve. The smaller one goes to a vent on the fuel tank. So you remove the smaller hose from the top of the vapor canister and slowly guide it out of the way as well. And then take your fuel hose and your crimper and lift the fuel tank out of the way. The next step will be to remove the two maintenance panels, and they're held in place with a large Phillips head screw. That's probably as good a place as any to take a break. Okay, this is an update. That's the reason why my shirt's a different color. I'm doing an update on the pulse ports for my kits now. The reason is to improve the fuel transfer characteristics when the generator is running in eco mode. So, in order to install the pulse port, remove the breather hose from the valve cover itself, and then go ahead and remove the valve cover. Keep a magnet nearby in case you're as clumsy as I am. Go ahead and pull the valve cover off. In this case, the valve cover has separated from the breather cover. Not a big deal, because ultimately you need to remove the breather cover from the valve cover for the next part of this job. The valve cover gasket has torn on this one. The kits come with a new valve cover gasket and a new breather cover gasket. If you tear the gaskets, make certain to use a new replacement gasket included in the kit. I'm going to go ahead and just scrape this piece of gasket off of here, so it does not create a leak.
Okay. Okay. The purpose of this, removing the breather plate and the valve cover, was so that we could disable the stock PCV valve, because we're going to be putting a new PCV valve external to the valve cover, so that we're not losing any crankcase pressure or vacuum through the breather line. We're able to take advantage of it first to drive the fuel pump and then send any extra out through the breather. If you wanted to, you could bend this back and forth and pull this rivet out. Some are easier said than done. I'm going to go ahead and just wiggle it till I get that rivet out. There it goes. This is one of the easy ones. So now we no longer have the reed valve in the valve cover area. Then we'll take the new breather plate gasket. Excuse me. I need the valve cover gasket, that's what I tore. You'll notice that the valve cover gasket has the tab at the bottom. The breather gasket is this one. It goes in with the gummy side facing the valve cover. But that's the one that I tore when I was removing it. Okay. What we're going to do is put the breather plate back into the valve cover. Then included with the kit, there's going to be a T-fitting. Take a section of the hose that's included in the kit and cut it off to where it's just barely longer than the tab on the T-fitting. Now the goal is to push this hose into the valve cover area. In fact, I'm going to go ahead and pull this breather out so you can see what I'm doing. pushing this hose into place so that it is now fully into the breather. And you'll notice that there's hose barbs on the T-fitting. The purpose that I'm going to use that hose barb for is I'm going to push this in to where the hose barb itself goes through the valve cover area and expands this hose on the inside. So that'll help retain it in, kind of like a door panel rivet on a car, the two-piece door panel rivets. Take a little bit of oil from the valve cover. And now you can see that the T-fitting is pushed into this section of rubber hose to the point where the hose barb on the T-fitting is inside the valve cover area. So now I can go ahead and put the breather plate back into place. Then take the hose that's included in the kit. You'll cut off the first section of hose is going to go into the bottom of the T-fitting and come back around into the new PCV valve. The other section is going to go onto the T-fitting and run up to the pulse line on the fuel pump. So when it goes up to the pulse line on the fuel pump, it's approximately 12 inches long. So we'll cut a 12-inch section for that. And this bolt is difficult to get in if you put the hose on first. So I'm going to go ahead and put the valve cover into place. Then this hose will be slid on. I'm just unplugging the spark plug so I can get that out of the way. Create just a little bit more room. This is the bolt that I said would be partially obscured by this hose. So we're going to put this bolt in here. And it's the one that's in the upper right-hand corner. I'm just going to pivot this T-fitting just a little bit to give me more room. If you don't have universal sockets, you may have to use an end wrench to tighten this bolt. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and rotate this T-fitting where it's parallel to the gasket surface area. I take the first section of hose that I cut to 12 inches in length. I'm going to pass it underneath the original breather hose and slide it on to this T-fitting. So now it's in place on the T-fitting. We're just going to tuck this up and out of the way. We'll finish that part of it later. Now I'm going to take the rest of the hose and I'm going to coil this around and slide it onto the bottom of this T-fitting and bring it around and over the top. Ultimately, what it's going to do is line up with the original breather hose, but it's going to have our one-way valve in it in this location. So I'm going to go ahead and cut it right here. And this is one of those issues where it's a good idea to go ahead and fit it on the generator. So you can see where you need to put it. Take the new PCV valve, slide it into this hose, and then slide it back into the stock hose. Take one of the zip ties that's included in the kit, and you'll notice that there's a bolt with a sleeve around it holding the stepper motor onto the top of the carburetor. Wrap the zip tie around that bolt, and it's a lot easier if you haven't cut your finger beforehand. In fact, cutting your finger beforehand makes all sorts of things more difficult. Makes it hard to remember what you're trying to say. You're going, man, I wish I hadn't done that. Everything now fits in there nicely, and this has very little chance of coming apart on you. It is not critical to put this tie wrap here, but you got plenty of tie wraps included in the kit. Your spark plug is still serviceable. Go ahead and lower this and start on the fuel pump. We'll sit right in this recessed area, right below the larger of the two hoses that goes to the purge canister, which is mounted in this corner here. So the hose that we just cut to length is going to run over, and it's going to go into the pulse port on the top of the fuel pump. Now, like I said earlier, you'll cut the hose just a little bit longer than it needs to be. I cut this one to 13 inches. I'm going to end up trimming about an inch and a half off of it. I still recommend cutting the hose longer than you think it's going to need to be, because you can always shorten it, and you cannot lengthen it once you cut it too short. Since the fuel pump is going to sit like this with the pulse port onto here, I'm going to trim it right at this location. I'm going to dip the end of it in just a little bit of oil
because it makes it go on so much easier. And this top port is the pulse port on the fuel pump. Take one of the large hose clamps included in the kit. Now I rotate the hose clamp down simply because it gives you a little bit more room for the next hose clamp. And then test fit it just to make sure that the fuel pump will sit down in there nicely. Because it's going to go under the breather hose. Ultimately, the fuel hose will go inside this clip along with the choke line or the choke wire. Just make sure that you can see that clearly with the camera. This white wire, incidentally, is to the temperature sensor that controls the choke actuator for the remote start. Okay. Now I'm going to remove the hose from the fuel selector valve that goes from the selector valve to the carburetor. This clip used to go onto the choke cable here, and this portion of it used to go onto the fuel line. You'll set that aside momentarily. We're going to leave the other end of this hose connected to the carburetor, as opposed to disconnecting it and then trying to reconnect it again. Ultimately, this hose will be cut and connected to the fuel filter, which will set approximately here. The reason why I like the fuel filter to be sitting here is because all you have to do is pull this panel off and you can clearly see the fuel filter at that time. Okay, this is probably as good a point as any to take a break. Okay, if you go from the bend of this hose, and this is the one that used to hook onto the fuel selector valve, go 3 1/4 inches from the inside of the bend. And that is where we're going to cut this hose. Now take this hose with the fuel tee. This fuel tee is supplied with the kit. So you'll notice that the hose bend and the fuel tee are facing the same direction. Then, take and cut off a section of the 1/4 inch hose supplied with the kit. There's approximately 5 feet of hose supplied with the kit. Cut a section about 3 1/2 inches long. You're going to trim it to the exact length later. And put that onto the fuel tee at this location. And then take a piece of fuel hose approximately 32 inches long, and put that onto the last fitting of the fuel T. Then install hose clamps, and they'll be included in the kit. Large hose clamp at this location, large hose clamp at this location, and a small hose clamp at this location. Now, you have to hold the camera up here at the top and film down. You'll see the blower housing, which is this area here, and then the air intake duct. There's a groove where the two of them match. You're going to run the hose underneath the wiring harness that goes for the 12-volt rectifier and around the blower housing and then curve it back around to where it faces out the front again. At that point, it should come out underneath the blower housing and out the front access panel here. The reason why I cut this hose at 32 inches long is because it's a lot easier to get a hold of it and pull it out. Now what we're going to do, actually I'm going to go ahead and unplug the temperature sensor for the choke. We'll hook that back up again later. I just want the fuel lines running underneath it. This hose is going to connect back on to the fuel selector valve where it was in the original stock generator. This hose is going to go to the fuel inlet port on the fuel pump, which is this one here. So first, we'll go ahead and hook this up to the fuel selector valve. We're going to use the stock clamp that came on that position. And that's back in place now. Like I said earlier, this particular generator has my remote start on it. And you'll notice the remote start actuator sits right here, and there's just enough room for the fuel line to run underneath the choke actuator. Then this hose that we trimmed, we cut off at 3.5 inches, will plug on to the inlet port on the carburetor, or on the fuel pump, excuse me. And then we'll put a large hose clamp in that location. At this point, you can reconnect the choke actuator if the generator you're working on happens to have an electric choke on it,
and one of my fuel, or one of my remote start.
I wanted to clarify the routing of the fuel line. This is the hose that hooks on to the fuel selector valve. You can see the elbow where it goes around. It then passes underneath the linear actuator for the choke if your generator has also got the wireless remote start kit of mine on it. This is the T with the 3.5-inch piece of tubing that connects to the fuel pump inlet. And this is the hose that I initially trimmed to 32 inches, and it lays right in the groove between the blower housing and the plastic fan shroud. It then goes right down, follows the line of the groove, and tucks in behind the air box and carburetor. If you come over to this view, you can see the hose as it goes along the gap. It then goes back under the engine. And comes out at this side here. And there is where it's connected on to the quick disconnect fitting. I initially routed the hose through as a 32-inch hose because it's a whole lot easier to grab a hold of the end of it. I then trimmed 10 inches off of the hose, so on this particular generator, it's left with a 22-inch hose. And anywhere between 21 and 23 is perfectly acceptable, depending on how tight you pull it. It seems to work out that about 22 is pretty good for me. The generator you're working on happens to have an electric choke on it and one of my fuel, or one of my remote start kits. Now there's one more port left on the fuel pump, and this port goes from the output line of the fuel pump. It'll come around and it'll go onto the fuel filter, which what we're going to do is take the shield that's on the stock hose and we're going to slide it down. Easier said than done. You notice there's an inner hose and an outer shield. Now when you route this hose around, make certain that it does not catch on the wire that pulls the choke. If you're running one of my fuel or one of my electric start kits, we're going to go ahead and hook the fuel filter to this hose. We use a small hose clamp in this location because the stock Yamaha hose is a thinner diameter, a thinner wall than the hose supplied with the kit. And then we'll go ahead and slide the abrasion guard that's around the stock hose right up against the hose clamp. So now the fuel line is going to run up over around the top of the air filter, up to the fuel filter, and then we're going to take another section of hose and run from the output on the pump to the input on the fuel filter. Now I originally started with the hose that I ran around here to be about 32 inches long.
when you trim off the end of it, you will have enough hose to run from the output of the fuel pump to the input on the fuel filter. If you started with this hose at less than 32 inches, you won't have enough to do that with this. You'll have to use another piece of hose. I got caught in my throat. Let's take a break. Okay, the piece of hose that I had left over that I trimmed off of the 32-inch line that I had running out the front is not quite long enough to do the job. So I'm taking the rest of the hose that's supplied with the kit, and I'm going to connect one end onto the output port on the fuel pump. Lay the fuel pump back down into place. I'm going to take the output line and wrap it around so that it connects onto the fuel filter in such a way that it doesn't force any sharp kinks. I'll line it up, select my place to cut the end off. I'm going to come right out here. Incidentally, the piece of hose I'm using here is 15 inches long. Take that, plug it onto your fuel filter, and simply route the fuel filter to where it lays up in this area right here, so that whenever you go to check the fuel filter in the future, you can just reach up and grab the fuel filter and pull it down so it's visible through this inspection cover. So what I'm going to do now is put a large hose clamp in this location. Another large hose clamp on the pump itself, on the output port. This way it all sits down in there nice and snug. Now if you come around to the front, find the hose that we had trimmed off. It's right here. What we're going to do is we're going to drill a hole into this panel, and we're going to mount our quick disconnect fitting at this location. If you take a flashlight and shine it behind here, you'll notice that there is an engine mount at this location, right at the edge of the inspection cover, so we definitely cannot go here. We must go back to just in front of the plastic area. You notice that this is made of plastic, so if we drill our hole in front of that, that's where we'll mount our quick disconnect fitting.
I use a step drill. If you have a step drill, go ahead and use it. If not, use whatever you have. But the hole for this is going to allow the quarter pipe fitting to go in. While I finish drilling this hole out. Okay, this is the quick disconnect fitting that comes in the kit. This is called a quarter pipe fitting. It is just slightly larger than a 1/2 inch. I've got this hole drilled to a 1/2 inch now because I want the fitting to go very tight. I'm not going to drill it all the way to a 9/16, so I'm going to take a repairman's reamer. Two things about it: the repairman's reamer will remove any burrs that were left by the drill bit, as well as reaming it out just slightly larger than a 1/2 inch. There's a couple of methods for this. You could take a drill bit a 1/2 inch and just wallow it a little bit, or drill it to a 9/16 if you do not have a repairman's reamer. At this point, take the brass hose barb included in the kit and thread it on to one of the quick disconnect fittings and check the gap right through here. You'll notice there's an inspection plug right here so you can see how much play you're going to have. And all I'm doing is feeling to see if there's a little bit of play around this. If, when you assemble it, if you start feeling tension on the threads when it's way back here, you'll notice that it won't quite pinch tightly around this piece of metal and yet close in this gap, which will allow this to spin back and forth. At that point, you'd have to use the large washer that's included in the kit as a shim. What you would do is just put the large washer around it and pass it through this. This particular unit definitely will not require that. Take the roll of Teflon tape that's included in the kit and wrap it several layers thick around the threads of the quick disconnect fitting. Do not overlap the edge. If you were to overlap the edge like this or something, that portion will get sheared off, and if you're lucky, it will make it all the way through to the fuel filter and get caught there. If you're unlucky, it will cause an obstruction before it gets to the fuel filter,
or stick in one of the fuel pump check valves and hang it open so that the fuel pump does not work properly. Ultimately, when I'm setting these up, I want the fuel fittings to face forward. That way the fuel hose will come around and snap on. Obviously, if it's facing straight up, this lip will prevent you from snapping the fuel line onto it. And if it's facing straight down, that makes it bad. If it's facing straight backwards, you can get it on, but it comes near the wheels and so forth like that. So it either needs to go forward or backward. My own personal preference is to have it face forward. Tightening the hose barb onto the back of the fuel fitting. Down. I want this to end up being perfectly parallel to the ground. It's not critical that it's perfectly parallel to the ground, but I like it that way. So, I'm going to have to tighten this up a little bit more. once you get this adjusted parallel to the ground, you'll take the hose right here that ran around the blower housing and then back under the generator and comes out here. You'll slide it onto the hose barb. Once it's all the way up on the hose barb, you'll take one more large hose clamp and clamp it securely in place. And incidentally, if you don't have a shop vac or something to vacuum up all the metal filings, I would strongly recommend at least taking a magnet and running it around, at least on the inside there, if you didn't have a shop vac with a vacuum pickup that can fit down in that area. So I wouldn't want you to leave metal filings inside a brand new generator. Take the rubber hose plug that I removed earlier. Incidentally, the total purpose of this plug is so you can get a wrench to drain the oil. You take a socket straight through here, pull the plug out of the bottom, and drain the oil out through the bottom. That is essentially the installation of the kit. The rest of it is putting the whole cabinetry assembly back together. That's probably as good a place as any to take a break for a moment. Okay, before we get ready to put the cabinet on, you just want to look over everything, make sure that there's no wires that are going to get pinched or anything else when you put the fuel tank on. Make sure that all the hose clamps are in place and that they're all tight. And then it's simply reinstallation of the fuel tank and the rest of the cabinetry. The fuel tank, if you had any fuel in it, you'll have a clamp on the fuel output hose. Then the emissions hose on this corner. The emission hose goes onto the small port. Once you get the hoses on, you'll be able to lean the tank up just a little bit and look in here and make sure that the hoses are nice and smooth flowing. And again, the fuel hose that goes from the tank is the one that goes straight in from the back. At this point, we go ahead and bolt the fuel tank in place. The fuel tank uses the shorter bolts. There are 8 of the short bolts. 4 of them hold the fuel tank on. The other 4 hold the fuel tank cover in place. Sideways. Notice when you're putting the fuel tank cover on that there's a sight glass. Make sure that that sight glass is aligned over the fuel gauge. It's actually possible to put the cover on 2 different ways. One way you'll be able to see the fuel gauge, the other way you will not. You'll take the other 4 short bolts, and they will be used to hold the fuel tank cover in place. Plastic covers. One of them will have a label that says hot exhaust. That one obviously goes over the exhaust end. There is a foam gasket inside these. Just make sure that the gasket material has not popped out. It goes up through the grooves here. If it pulls out, just tuck it back into place. Covers are the ones that use the longer bolts because they do have the spacers, there's metal inserts where it goes through the plastic. I will be able to get all the covers on before the foam ends again. This end, because I have the wireless remote installed already, is slightly trickier than if it did not. What I do is I route the antenna wire right through this recessed area. You notice it's indented right by the battery tray. The antenna wire, I route through that recessed area, that way it's not pinched. This also has the foam gasket on this end. Just make sure that the foam gasket is still in place. protect your antenna wire, and it still flows smoothly, so you know at that point it is not pinched. I put the antenna on top of the fuel cap. Reason being, the fuel cap is the highest point on a generator, and it's just like with a TV antenna. The higher up in the air you get it, the better your reception is. The rear cover. Just make sure that your fuel gate or your fuel filter is up out of the way. Rear cover is held on with a single Phillips head screw. You simply tuck the two bottom tabs into place. The front cover is put on the same way. Decal, because of the way the Yamaha is laid out. Either my suggestion would be to put the decal either here or on the hatch cover. And this is simple operating instructions for the remote fuel kit, in case the person operating the generator is not the same person that installed it. Okay, the next part will be that the kit also includes a genuine Yamaha fuel hose. They're 10 feet long with quick disconnects on both ends. And an additional Yamaha quick disconnect fitting, which goes in the fuel tank. I'll go ahead and demonstrate starting and running procedure with this tank. Like I said, you won't get one of these nasty hoses. You will get a genuine Yamaha fuel hose, which is 10 feet long instead of 7 feet long. The procedure for running the generator is, number one, make sure that there's fuel in the remote tank. Then take the prime bulb and make sure that the arrow on the prime bulb is facing in the direction of fuel flow, which means from the tank to the generator. Connect one end of the hose to the tank. Connect the other end of the hose to the generator. Make sure that the vent on the remote tank is open. Then move the fuel selector valve on the generator to the on position. Then pump the prime bulb until it feels firm. That usually takes about 3 or 4 pumps. What we're doing is just forcing the air that's in the hose up. It's pushing fuel into the hose, which pushes the air out of it, pushes it into the quick disconnect fitting, around through the fuel filter, in through the fuel pump, and in with the fuel selector valve in the on position for priming it. It then puts fuel into the stock tank, and the air bubble is vented out through the stock fuel tank vent. Now that you've got the air bubble primed out of it, move the fuel selector valve to the off position. And think of the fuel selector valve as remote tank and stock tank. So the on position would be running off the stock tank normally, and you'd put it in the off position anytime you wanted to run off the remote tank. And after that, starting is very simple. This particular generator has my wireless remote control system on it, so the choking operation is completely automatic. So because of that, I won't be using the choke, but normally you would use the choke if you did not have my wireless remote on there. shameless advertising plug for my wireless remote, by the way. And that's it. It's pretty straightforward and simple.